you this morning in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and what a joy it is to see you all here today as we celebrate 180 years of the life of this church. And it is a joyous occasion at that. Just a couple of quick announcements, and then we're going to move on. If at any time during the service you need to excuse yourself, the door to my right, your left, out into the hallway. Also, after the service today, we have an excellent meal planned for everybody so that we hope that you can stick around to share and some lunch with us and share in our time of fellowship together. You're all welcome to stay for that. And just as a way to kind of let's call it a survey. Who here came to be a member of Bethany from 2020 and beyond? Anytime between 2020 and 2023. All right, what about between 2010 and 2020? What about from 1990 to 2020? All right, what about 1980 to 1990? And we're getting there. What about 1970 to 1980? Wow. All right, 60 to 70? Man. 50 to 60? Wow. 40 to 50? Wow, it goes back quite a way. Well, awesome. Thank you all very much. I'm sorry? Oh, how many Girl Scouts?
Because we were all in the basement.
How many pastors, youth directors, or worship leaders are here? Stand for me for just a minute. Pastors, worship leaders, youth directors, let's give them a hand. Thank you all. Just satisfying my own curiosity. Now, if you don't mind, I'm going to ask you to stand one more time as we say the Apostles' Creed. Would that be all right? We'll do our church gymnastics today. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you.
Our first reading is from Isaiah 40, 28 through 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Thank you. One of the privileges that I have today, or one of the privileges I should say I'm going to take today, is to introduce some of the people that are going to speak here this morning, some people that I look up to and respect. And the first person that's going to speak here in just a minute is somebody that is our district superintendent now, but John is unique in the way, and this is my opinion, this is my view. To me, John Hatton is unique in the way that he leads this district. The best word I can use to describe the way that he leads the district is a shepherd. He not only cares for the churches, all the people that are in the churches, all the people that he's in charge of looking over, but he cares for the pastors. And he tries to help them walk through their own life, through their own life in ministry, their own journey in ministry. I think God's calling. So it's my pleasure to introduce to you all my boss. So everybody talk nice about me when you see John at lunch. Make sure you say good things about me. John Hatton.
Gosh, thank you so much, Matthew. I don't know if I deserve But thank you so much. And it's good to serve alongside with you, Matthew. It really, really is. And as Matthew shared, my name is John. I'm a fellow disciple of Jesus Christ with you all. And I do bring you greetings this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. This is a wonderful day. I was sharing with a few of you all as I was shaking hands that for our country, having a church celebrate 180 years worth of ministry is very much a powerful witness in the world. Our country isn't that old. When you consider, if you go overseas, you know, and hang around in Europe for a while, they're talking 1,000 years, you know, 1,500 years. But for us, we're a little bit on the more shorter end of that history. And so your church has these roots in the earlier times of our country, and I think that's beautiful. There's a lot of emotion for me on this day as well, because I know some of the history here, and one of your pastors was one of those persons who was a big giant for me as I was a youth growing up. David Sparks was here, and he was minister to you all, and he was minister to me. And you all ministered to him, too. And so thank you. On days like this, I'm reminded of the rich texts of Holy Scripture that speak to the faithfulness of God, as well as Christ's Spirit who indwells and empowers the church for the work of the kingdom. And this is an important thing to remember on days like this, because it's not about me or you, it's about Jesus and about his Spirit that is here in this place today. God's here. God is present. And God allows us to partner with him and empowers us to be doing the work of the kingdom, and that's amazing. Now, I want to invite you just for a moment to let your mind explore these wonders of Scripture for the next few seconds. Think on these things, about how God has had this patient faithfulness. The Exodus for the Hebrews out of Egypt. The promise of Abraham. The broken and the restored heart of King David. The fall and the return of Judah. The emptiness of the intertestamental period. And what a dark, silent time that was. Followed by the gift and the promise of a child to Zechariah and Elizabeth. The one who would announce the Messiah. The ministry of Jesus amidst his own people who rejected him. Can you imagine the patience of Jesus in that? And the gift of the Spirit at Pentecost that empowers you, the church, today. These are the wonders of God. And these wonders, they bring hope. The letter to the Hebrews speaks of the long-standing faithfulness of God throughout all of time. It speaks about how God is a refuge and a strength that we can flee to in any time that we're in, and that this hope and this strength is a strong and trustworthy anchor, an anchor for our souls. Have you ever felt a need of an anchor in these days? God is there to be that anchor that holds you in the midst of the swirling waters. And it leads us, the book of Hebrews says, to God's inner sanctuary. And so today we gather in this inner sanctuary of God, and we reflect upon 180 years of lived out hope. Lived out hope. And yet we also look to the future that lies before us because God is doing amazing and wonderful things. I wished I had 30 minutes to tell you about all of the revival and renewal that God is bringing to Kentucky right now. But today we look to the past and we remember that we are empowered by God. And when we look to the past, one of the things that it does is it allows us to move forward faithfully into the future. And so with these promises of God and with this hope, Bethany's future is just as fruitful as her past. Bless you all. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, John. Friends, I've thought a lot about this day, thought about it for months, and what I might say today about Bethany. I thought about the humble beginnings of this church when it was once just a rickety building with a mud roof. The early days of the church when this was mostly a farming community. And I understand that back then, as these communities were forming, one of the first buildings they usually would construct, one of the first buildings that was important for them to get under roof and under construction was a church, because it meant so much to the people when they were building these communities. And through the years, this church has been in several different locations. The building and the sanctuaries have been in various shapes and sizes and so forth. But we're not here today to talk about a building, but a people, but a body of Christ. The people who worship here every Sunday morning have heard me say this many times. I have often wished that we had another word to talk about these buildings in which we worship besides calling them the church, because you are the church. So today we're not here to celebrate a building or a place. We're here to celebrate God's people. And for 180 years, Bethany has stood pretty strong. And they have had faithful brothers and sisters in Christ who have done the very best that they could to serve, to be a part of, and to help shape this community. And I can tell you that that tradition continues with the body of Christ that worships here every Sunday morning. And that's what we're here to celebrate today, God's people. I don't want to take up a lot of time, but I do want to point out one very important event in the life of our church, in the life of Bethany. And that came in June of 2015. You see, in June in 2015, Bethany and Pleasure Ridge Park United Methodist Church merged. And I don't have the right words or the vocabulary to tell you what a blessing that those people from PRP have been to this church, to the people of this church. So we're not only celebrating one church today, we're celebrating two. The life and the ministry of Bethany, but also from the folks of Pleasure Ridge Park and their rich history and their what all the good work that God had done through them, through their church. So I'm going to invite Miss Marilyn Puckett to come up and say a few words about Pleasure Ridge Park.
Former member of Pleasure Ridge Park United Methodist Church. 8 years ago, on July the 5th, 2015, Pleasure Ridge Park members came to our first service. And that's when we became part of Bethany's history. Due to declining membership, Pleasure Ridge Park was faced with the difficult decision of whether or not we could continue as a congregation. It's said that when one door closes, another opens. When the doors of Pleasure Ridge Park closed, the doors of Bethany opened wide to welcome us in. In looking back, I believe it was clear where God was at work in guiding us to merge with Bethany. Our district superintendent at the time, Reverend Becky Curry, was very supportive and encouraging in her guidance through the process. There were many connections already in place. We were already sharing a pastor, Pastor David Sparks, and then Pastor Clayton Vertrees. We already knew each other better than we realized at the time. Friendships and relationships between members of the two congregations had already been formed through several community ministries, such as the annual community Lent services and World Day of Prayer, as well as Southwest Community Ministries and more. Prior to PRP's closing, we had jointly held two vacation Bible schools at PRP, and a youth group was being formed. By the time PRP closed, it just felt natural to move on down Dixie Highway to Bethany, our new church home. The Bethany church family could not have been more friendly and welcoming. They took us under their wings and put us to work. The Bethany church family is a loving family. We love the Lord and we love and care about each other. All of us, whether longtime members or members for a short time, are truly blessed to be a part of the Bethany church family. It's a great place to be. So to all who are here today, welcome home to Bethany. Happy homecoming.
I want to share just a little bit with you here for just a minute. I'm not going to take up too much time. I know everybody's waiting to hear the bishop preach. But let me share a quote to begin with. Let me share a quote from C.S. Lewis, and it talks about love. He wrote this: "To love at all is to be vulnerable. Love anything and your heart will be wrung and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must not give it to anyone, not even to an animal. Wrap it up carefully, round with hobbies and little luxuries, and avoid all entanglements. Lock it up safe in a casket or coffin of your own selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, and airless, it will change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, and therefore irredeemable. To love is to be vulnerable." If anybody has ever told you that being a Christian was easy, if anybody ever told you doing the work of the kingdom of God is easy, well, they likely weren't telling you the whole story, or they weren't being real honest. As Christians, we are called to love, and we are called to love like nobody else. We are called to love like Christ taught us. We are called to love like Christ commanded us. And to do so, it means that we do so in sacrifice of our own heart. It's sort of a reckless abandonment of our own heart and our own emotions to try to reach other people, to show them that love. When you love like Christ loved, well, then your heart's likely going to get hurt. And your heart can likely be broken. We're going to try, we're going to fail, and we're going to feel defeated, and our hearts will hurt. And sometimes they'll be broken. You're going to get rejected by some, and some might call you names. And our hearts will hurt, and sometimes they might feel broken. We're going to struggle in our own lives and in the midst of our own struggles and our own challenges in life. We're still called to love like Christ loved. And our hearts will hurt, and sometimes they'll be broken. Athletes have this saying. They say, "I left it all on the field." That means they gave it their all. For Christians who are called to love with a radical kind of love, that means for us, we have to leave it all on the field. That means we have to risk our own hearts on the battlefield that we all fight to love each other. And sometimes those people that we're called to love aren't always easy to love. And our hearts will hurt, and sometimes they can be broken. To love our brothers and sisters in Christ in the way that Christ has called us means that we have to risk our own hearts. There is a term that I've heard on the television and the news at sometimes, and I know it's meant as a derogatory term. They talk about radical Christians sometimes. And I haven't liked that term. But if we're known as radical Christians because of the way that we love one another radically, then I'm okay with it. If we could somehow turn that around, if we could somehow turn that into something good because we choose to love one another in a radical way. The way I see it, we all have a choice. Like C.S. Lewis sort of laid it out in his little paragraph that I read there. We have a choice. We can guard our hearts. We can protect them. We can wrap them up. We can never share them with anybody. We can let the world kind of harden that heart to where we don't love and our hearts won't get broken. Our hearts won't hurt. But Christ left it all in the field. On the day that he went to the cross, what else could he have given for all of us? He risked it all for us so that we could then turn around and maybe risk our own hearts a little bit on the battlefield to love one another in the way in which we are called. It got me. So now I'm going to call up somebody that, another special person in the life of me and the life of this church. Becky was the district superintendent when I first got into ministry. She sort of guided me along, sometimes pushed me certain directions. I was still a little reluctant. But she too is a shepherd in her own way. But I'm just going to tell you this story that to me speaks volumes about who she is. Last year, as most of you probably remember, I did a funeral for my mother-in-law and my father-in-law. And at one of those funerals, and I'm not going to remember which one it was, Becky showed up. And she said, "I'm here to pray for you." She went out of her way. She took time out of her day. Come out here and show a little Christ-like love. And to me, that speaks heart. That speaks volumes about her heart. So, Reverend Becky Curry.
I asked Matthew, I said, "Now you're not going to get a little weepy on me, are you?" So,
I lied.
Yeah, you did. Bishop Fairley and John and friends at Bethany, it is such a joy to be here today and to celebrate 180 years of ministry at Bethany. I'm a product of this church. And so Matthew asked me if I would come and just share some of the memories that I have from the 50s and the 60s, a time which some people would say was the heyday of the church. You see, I was fortunate enough to be among the little children who would climb the steps to the top of the building for morning exercises. We were greeted by Miss Sally and Miss Elizabeth and Miss Nancy and my mom, Miss Liz. And we would sing songs that taught us about God and Jesus and the Bible. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son," and the B-I-B-L-E and "This Little Light of Mine." And on a really good day, Miss Sally would lead us in "Joshua the Battle of Jericho" and "Little David Play on Your Harp." Miss Sally White could make those keys on the piano dance. And Nancy Tunnell reminded me not long ago of the importance of the birthday chair, that on your birthday you were called forward and you got to sit in the chair and put your pennies in a plastic cake. Sunday school was an important part of Bethany for children and adults. There were Sunday school picnics on the river and socials at the church. I was fortunate to be a part of a family that was in the life of the church at Bethany. I was fortunate to be able to worship in Mormon Chapel. It was a very special and sacred place for many of us. I learned about communion at Mormon Chapel. I remember the Sunday that my mother told me to sit with my aunt while she went forward to take communion. Well, I was having none of that. I wanted to know what was going on up there, and so I bolted to the altar to find out about this mystery of faith. I learned, and I also learned about the importance of obeying your mother. I was fortunate to attend Sunday night services in the Mormon chapel. It was great. It was there that we got to call out the names of the songs that we wanted to sing out of the Cokesbury hymnal, like Church in the Wildwood, Oh Come, 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 and Whispering Hope, and His Eye is on the Sparrow. I can't tell you how many times I have pulled from those songs in times of when I needed them. Why should I be discouraged? Why should the shadow fall? His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I was fortunate to witness the growth of the church physically and spiritually. We built a new sanctuary and filled it in no time. I hated to leave the intimacy of the Mormon chapel, but the new church was so big and grand, and it served us well. Little did I know that as I watched it being built, when I guess I was 5 years old, that that would be the place where I would take my wedding vows. And Ken and I were married in that church in 1976. I was also fortunate to be a part of the youth group. About the time I graduated from the children's department to the youth department, Reverend Kermit Fleener and John and Doris Weber arrived on the scene, and the youth program began to grow. There were retreats and Bible studies and Sunday afternoon sub-district meetings and weeks at Lucon. Kids who didn't go to church or kids who went to other churches began to come to Bethany. It was the place to be. The summer after my freshman year, Doris Weber took me every day with her to the Wesley house, where she was a social worker. And it was there that another one of those children's choruses came alive for me. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. It was there I learned about poverty and social injustices and how the church was reaching out to solve some of those issues. I had become a Christian at a revival, but I think it was that summer that I became a Methodist. As youth were nurtured, encouraged, and challenged to be more like Jesus, there were several of us who went on to ministry. Nancy Tennell, Don Dotson, Jim Starr, Rick Barstead, Al Krause, Doug Lyon, and if I forgot somebody, forgive me. God was at work in the hearts of the people at Bethany, and I was indeed fortunate. And speaking of ministers who came out of Bethany, there's one more. When David Sparks was the minister at Bethany a few years ago, he saw the possibilities and potentials in a young man. And just like Kermit Fleener and John Weber had encouraged us all, David Sparks encouraged Matthew Oakes. And now he is your pastor. And he has completed the course of study, and we are blessed to include him in that list of ministers from Bethany. Thank you, Matthew, for all you have done for this church and for picking up the torch. God bless you. And so this morning we gather to reminisce and to share our stories. We all have different stories, and we remember them differently. But I want to share with you two lessons that I learned from Bethany that I have taken with me. The first one is the importance of being in church every Sunday. To this day, I can tell you where the people of Bethany sat. You see, there were the Colletts and the Smothers and the Dotsons and the Elliots and down over here. And over here were the Mormons and the other Swindlers and the Bashams. And in the choir was Miss Elizabeth Wyatt and Dorothy Sherwalk and Pauline Weiss and John Terry and John Smith. Their presence was their witness. In my eyes, it was their way of saying that they loved Jesus And so when you roll over in the bed on Sunday morning and you say it doesn't matter whether you go to church or not, I want to tell you, it does. There are eyes that are watching you, and you have no idea how important that can be. The second lesson was a little more painful, and at Bethany, we don't talk about it very much. But I so vividly remember the split in our church. It was a difference in theology. The minister was a dynamite preacher, and I loved to hear him preach. But he was leading the church in a different direction than from what some people felt it should be like. And he was asked to leave, not only Bethany, but the denomination. And people went with him. It was ugly. There was fighting and ugly words. Suddenly, some of those pews were empty, and I didn't see those familiar faces on Sunday morning, and my heart was broken. One night, I came home from church and went to my room and cried. My mother came in and gave me words that have stuck with me and strengthened me throughout the years. Becky, what is happening at church has nothing to do with your relationship with the Lord. That's between you and Him. And those words have given me a priority through the years. Bethany survived the split. With the help of Brother Russell and Kermit Fleener and John Weber, we flourished again, but there was always a battle scar. As a DS, I saw churches fighting, and it reminded me of those days at Bethany. My heart would break again, and I would caution them to remind them of what they might be doing to the children in their church. I would also remind them that it had nothing to do with their relation. It had everything, but their fighting had nothing to do with their relationship with Christ. Theology is important, but never more important than loving the Lord and loving each other. And even now in our denominational upheaval, we cannot allow our personal relationship with Christ to waver. If things get a little wacky and we feel like things are falling apart, we will survive. We will flourish again, just like Bethany did in the 60s, and as we see it flourish now. I have shared some of my memories and lessons. I have forgotten many, and I left out many. So it's your turn. And I hope that later on you will gather with friends and you will share your stories and memories and celebrate. Yes, celebrate that we have come from a long tradition of Christian men and women who set a path for us and others to come to know Christ as Lord and Savior. We are indeed fortunate to be a part of the Bethany family. Will you pray with me? Loving God, we do come in your presence today to give thanks to you for all you have done for us. As you have walked with us through the years, as we have shared our faith, as we have heard the stories, as we remember that you died on the cross for us. As we come today, we also ask for forgiveness for our many failures, when we have been selfish and we've thought only about ourselves and not the other person. We ask that you would give us a sense of your forgiveness and that we might be white as snow once again. We pray for the people in this church who have special needs this morning, those who are sick, those who are lonely, those who feel isolated, and maybe think the church doesn't care about them anymore. Lord, help us to reach out to them. Take our hands and our feet and lead them. Lead us to them so they might know that they are loved by us and by you. Be with us now as we celebrate and as we worship, and we will give you all the glory. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our second reading is from Colossians, verse 1, chapter 1, verses 15 through 20. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body of the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross.
Ushers, if y'all would come forward. I want to let you all know in the spirit of today, in the spirit of talking about the kingdom of God, the offering that we're going to collect today, we're going to give 50% of it away. I want to send 25% of it to the children's home and another 25% to the Wesley retirement facility. So we want to share what you give today. So if you wouldn't mind, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this day, for the wise words that have been spoken in the walls of this sanctuary today, Lord. And now as we give a small portion of what you have blessed our lives with, may we make that very same and simple, humble request. Father, you take it, you use it, and you teach us to be good stewards of all that you provide. In Jesus' great name we pray. Amen.
Oh,
Would you stand for the doxology, please? You all be seated, please. Now it's the moment that I know you've all been waiting for. You've all been waiting for to hear our bishop preach. I know he'll set the pulpit on fire here in just a minute. But first, Bishop, I don't think I ever told you. You settled a long-standing discussion in our house when you first came to Kentucky. I went home after the first time watching you preach, and I went home and I said, Lisa, the bishop preached in bare feet. And I said, if the bishop can preach in bare feet, I can wear my boots. So I thank you. She's still not happy about it, but I get to wear my boots to church. So anyway, what can I say about Bishop Fairley? For a long time, you all have heard me talk about this, I was in law enforcement for many years. And there was a time when I would have never looked at a pastor of a church or somebody associated with a church, and I would never have looked at them and considered them a warrior until I met the bishop. He is a spiritual warrior. We all know the trouble this church has had for the last few years, right? We know that there's been hard times. And that the problem is when there's hard times in the midst of an organization, we all know the one at the top takes a lot of heat, takes a lot of blame, misplaced blame. And people usually lash out at the person who's in charge. And he's taken all of that and continued to smile and continued to serve. I'm sure he's had his moments. I'm sure he is human. But recently, we were out at the conference office, and he gave a little talk one day, and he preached a little bit, and I liked what he said. He said, my soul, my heart is too important to me to let this, and these are my words, to let that harden his heart to what God has called him to do, and that is to lead the Kentucky Annual Conference, to keep that spirit of Christ alive inside of him, and to not let his heart be hardened about all the things that he has experienced, but instead to choose love, which is why I talked about love in the beginning, to choose to continue to love like Christ, to love those who might be a little difficult to love those who may have hurt your heart or broken your heart in some way, to choose love over anger, to choose love over bitterness, to choose the love of Christ over all else, even if it means leaving your own heart on the battle or the field to love like Christ. Please welcome Bishop Leonard Fairley.
Well, I do want to apologize to your wife. I'm sorry if I caused so much trouble.
I am so sorry. I was going to move that to the center, but I'll stand here. And I... just hearing the stories, oh man, my heart is full. And I give thanks that God is good all the time. Not some of the time, but all the time. And so I've just come to share a little bit with you, and I'll share from these words that don't sound like a homecoming or anniversary text. But it reads like this, Matthew 26. Now, while Jesus was at Bethany, in Simon the leper's house, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, and she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when the disciples saw it, they were angry and said, "Why this waste? For this ointment could have been sold for a large sum and the money given to the poor." But Jesus, aware of this, said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. By pouring this ointment on my body, she has prepared me for burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her." While Jesus was at Bethany, let us pray. And now, Lord, we simply ask that you would open our hearts and our minds and our souls so that we, your gathered people, might receive your word with thanksgiving and with praise. And as always, O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be found acceptable in your sight, my Lord and my Redeemer. In the strong name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. While Jesus was at Bethany. Now, these words and this text from the 26th Gospel, the Gospel according to St. Matthew, seem like the last biblical text that you would be told that you would choose to preach a sermon at a 180th church anniversary and homecoming. But I want you to ponder this for me. What if it is a call for Bethany United Methodist Church to remember who you are and whose you are? What if it is a call to you for you to live into your name? For 180 years, this church has been called to be home. It has been called to be a home of Christian community. It has been called to be a place where souls can find bread for the journey and living water for their spiritual thirst. Home. A place where people could find forgiveness of their sins and a grace that would always be sufficient no matter what the need was. And so you have been invited to gather in this space today and to share stories and to share hopes and to share memories and to remember people's faces and remember those stories that make you laugh and sometimes make you weep. But you have been invited here to come home, to celebrate this 180th anniversary at Bethany, because home is where the heart is. Home is a place where you discover peace from all the distraction of the world. Where is the place where you feel like you're at home? When you need a little peace, when you need rest, when you need comfort, when you need some joy. And I don't know about you, every once in my life I could use some joy. I can use some laughter. I can use the fact of being able to remember where God has brought me from. The place where you can hear the stories of Jesus, where is home? The place where you feel like you are among family and you don't have to be anything else but yourself. In my language, we call it you don't have to front. You could be who God has called you to be. Bethany United Methodist Church, you have been called and you have been set aside in this community to be a spiritual home in a world that seems to be daily turning upside down. You are called to be a home where men, women, and children can find serenity and a light that pushes against the darkness. Home, a place of serenity where the words of Reinhold Niebuhr's prayer for serenity ring true. And all of us, if I asked you to quote this, you could do it. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. The courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. And most people would end that poem right there, but it goes on a little bit farther. He goes on to say, living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace. Taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it. Trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Bethany, are you creating a place of serenity while Jesus was at Bethany? You see, if you continue to read the stories of Jesus, you will discover that Bethany holds a special place in the heart of Jesus. Bethany is the place where Jesus chooses as a home away from home whenever he journeyed to Jerusalem, especially during the feast of the Passover when the city was packed. Bethany is the place where Jesus laid his head, the place that was home the night before his triumphal entry when the people shouted, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Bethany was Jesus' home away from home. It was that place that he would travel a half hour journey back and forth night after night during his final week on earth. It was in Bethany that he would leave the temple after preaching and after being rejected and ridiculed. He would go home to Bethany, that place where he could lay his head and pray about what was coming next. Everybody needs a Bethany. And it is my prayer that Bethany United Methodist Church will continue to be a place where the weary find rest and a home. I pray that this church will be a place where people can find forgiveness, a place where they can confess their sin and discover a joy that is found in the mercy and the grace and the redemption and the reconciliation offered by Jesus Christ. I hope that you are that kind of church. While Jesus was at Bethany, he discovered a place and a home as he prepared to give his life for the salvation of the world. Jesus needed a Bethany, a place called home, to lay his head. He found a place of peace, a place called home in Bethany United Methodist Church. For 180 years, you have been a place called home for countless people. And today is the day to sit at the table and share those stories about those people. Home, a place where you have shared joys and celebrations and the ups and downs of life together. Home, a place where people have come through the waters of baptism, where a minister in this place says, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all of this is God's gift offered without price. Home. A place where couples have walked down the aisle for Christian marriage. home a place where you have gathered during times of grief and loss, where you have wept together. Many of you may not know my story, but there was nine of us, and we were brought up in a Seventh-day Adventist church, and I remember Miss Almeda Blackman would teach us Bible verses, and she'd give us a piece of candy for every Bible verse we remembered, and mine was always Jesus wept. And I told my brothers and sisters, if you take my verse, I'll whip your butt. Now, that's some kind of talk. But Jesus needed a Bethany where he could pour out his heart, to where he can weep if he needed to weep. And I hope that you are that kind of church. For home is a place where we are invited to share a meal of grace in the table of a holy meal of cup and bread. Home. A place where for 100 years the scriptures have been taught and proclaimed. Hope. A place where fellowship meals and youth group activities made Bethany a home for somebody who did not have a home. Home. A place where people have cried together, rejoiced together, and prayed together, and walked through the difficulties of life together. For 180 years, you have been home for people needing a Bethany. Pastor David Sparks and his family knew what home meant, for they found it here during the roughest part of his and their journey. And Dawn and I continue to give thanks that it was here at Bethany, while serving as your pastor, that David found a home as he traveled through his final journey toward the church, triumphant to that house, that home not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens. And thanks be to God. And I hope that you are still being a home to those who need water for the journey, for those who are looking for the bread of life, for those who are suffering through the midnight of some trouble, for those who've been weeping in the midnight hour. You see, folk, they just don't happen to come to your church by accident. They come looking for something. And it is my prayer, Bethany, that you will give it every single time. It matters not what side of the tracks that person comes from. It matters not the color of that person's skin. It matters not. All that matters is they have found living bread and living water in this congregation. Bethany is a home where brokenness is found healing. You don't go to Bethany to seek fame or fortune. You go there because it is a place of belonging. And isn't that what the world needs right now? A place where people can find a sense of healing, an affirmation that they are loved, a place where true dignity can be found. Be that kind of church. You know, you just didn't up and jump and be this place that you are today. If you did, I got news for you. It is no accident that somebody decided to give this church the name Bethany. And it is my prayer and my desire that you will live into that place. Bethany, a place, home, where faith is shaped and formed. It is like they say, charity begins at home. As I looked at Pastor Becky standing up here talking and sharing her story about what she remembered about the church, it reminds me that that is where we first learn how to love. Some child sitting in this church, the only way that they will know how to love is because you will teach them. You know, I often ask myself in this world, where did people go to church? When I listen to what some people say and how they talk, I say, who in the world taught you about love? What did you learn? The stories of Jesus. We have this opportunity in front of us to tell the stories of Jesus. Here at Bethany United Methodist Church, for 180 years, people have learned again how to pray together, laugh together, and follow Christ together. You see, the world does not need profound argument to convince people that Jesus is who Jesus says he is. You know how people will know that? I think St. Francis said it better. He said these words, and these are attributed to him. I don't know if they are really his. But he says, if you need to preach the word of God, sometimes use words. I know I'm not quoting that all the way right. People. Home is a place where people let the life they live speak for them. Now, you could have all the theological arguments with me that you want to have in the world. But that old youth song that we learned, they will know you're a Christian how? You could talk back to me. They will know you are Christians by your love. Of course, people need a home where they grow and where they understand who they are and whose they are in Christ Jesus. But I also believe that people need a home where they know beyond a shadow of a doubt that they are loved, that they are accepted and forgiven. For 180 years of celebrating anniversaries and homecoming, people have found a home here where they find the experience of a reviving presence of Jesus Christ, a home where they could be spiritually renewed. Will you be that church? I pray that as you celebrate this 180th anniversary, that you will give Jesus your undivided attention. And as I think about this homecoming and this anniversary, there's a story that always hits me. And it is the story of a group of a monastery. And the story is entitled, The Messiah in Disguise. It is a story about a monastery that had fallen on hard times. And it was once a part of a great order, which because of religious persecution lost all its branches. And it was decimated to the extent that there were only 5 monks left in the abbey, the abbot and 4 others. And all of them were over 70 years old. Now, I hesitated to use that one, but it's in the story. They were all over 70 years old. Clearly, it was a dying order. And deep in the woods surrounding the monastery was a little hut that the rabbi from a nearby town occasionally used the hermitage. And one day it occurred to the abbot to visit the hermitage to see if the rabbi could that might save the monastery. And the to commiserate together, and I know how it is, the rabbi said. The spirit has gone out of the people. Almost no one comes to the synagogue anymore. So the old rabbi and the old abbot wept together, and they spoke quietly and deeply of deep things. And the time came when the abbot had to leave, and they embraced. It's been wonderful being with you, said the abbot, but I failed in my purpose for coming. Have you no advice that might save the monastery? No, I'm sorry, I don't have any advice to give you, the rabbi said. The only thing I can tell you is that the Messiah is one of you in disguise. And when the other monks heard the rabbi's word, they wondered what possible significance they might have. The Messiah is one of us in disguise, one of us here at the monastery. Do you suppose he meant the abbot? Of course, it must be the abbot. He's been our leader for so long.
On the other hand, he might have met Brother Thomas, who is undoubtedly a holy man. Certainly he couldn't have met Brother Elrod. He's so crotchety. But Elrod is very wise. Surely he could not have met Brother Philip. He's too passive. But then magically, he's always there when you need him. Of course, he didn't mean me, yet supposing he did, oh Lord, not me. You can't mean me. I couldn't mean that much to you. And as they contemplated in this manner, the old monks began to do an amazing thing. They began to treat each other with extraordinary respect on the off chance that one of them might be the Messiah in disguise. Because the forest in which the monastery was situated was beautiful, people occasionally came to visit the monastery and to picnic or to wander along the old path, and which mostly led to the dilapidated chapel. And they sensed this aurora, this extraordinary respect that surrounded the five old monks, and it just permeated the atmosphere. There was something about the atmosphere that whenever they were around these monks, there was something different. There was something spiritual happening. There was something extraordinary happening. They were not talking to each other like they used to talk. And people began to come more frequently, and they began to bring friends, and their friends brought friends, and some of the younger men who came to visit it began to engage in conversation with the monks, and after a while, one asked if he might join, and then another, and another, and within years, the monastery became once again a thriving order. And thanks to the rabbi's gift, a vibrant community of light and love. And here's my question. What would happen if in Bethany United Methodist Church, we treated everybody as if they were Jesus in disguise? I look at your pictures. As I came in, Pastor Matthew showed me the pictures along the wall. And somebody in here had to be treating one another as if they were Jesus in disguise. It's possible that we are welcoming angels unawares. What if for the next 180 years you treated everybody? What if for 180 years and beyond, you worship in this place as if Jesus might walk through the door at any time? What if you did that? What a blessing you would be home while Jesus was at Bethany. That's what he experienced. Living to your name. Be the Bethany that God has called you to be. And may it be here that people find a place of love, acceptance, forgiveness, and grace. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.